Although only about maybe 3% of the available land area in the world is urbanized, cities are responsible for more than 75% of the carbon dioxide that's emitted into the atmosphere. By managing the climates of cities, I would to some extent be able to manage the climate of the planet. It is actions at a city scale, accumulated, aggregated, that drive the anthropogenic, the human-driven changes in the planetary atmosphere. Increasingly, however, we understand cities as complex arrangements of lots of different types of microclimates, and our job is to try and assemble all that information to give a view as to how the entire city is behaving. If I was to measure at the height of a human inside a city, I'd be below the heights of buildings. And what I would experience is an immense variety of microclimates, depending on where the sun is located, where the wind is located, where there's a tree in the street, depending on the materials of the buildings, whether there's grass present. In other words, an endless array of different types of effects, all of which generate climates at a very, very small scale. So how do I abstract from that to tell us what the climate effect of the city is as a whole? It's not a simple matter. But there are certainly many examples of cities that have clearly gone down the wrong path and are now trying to reverse themselves. If I take the Chinese cities that are emerging, the sheer scale of the urbanization process, the level of industry, the level of pollution is simply astonishing. Everything that we learned from New York City, Los Angeles, Dublin, London in the past, the big German cities in the past about air quality seems to have been entirely forgotten and is being relearned in those cities. So you get air quality inside Beijing that's clearly hazardous. How are you going to fix that? Well, I know the Chinese cities are talking about trying to build in ventilation corridors to allow the air to sweep through the city and wash out all the air. But fundamentally, they're fighting a losing battle. Changing the structure of the city to try and get more ventilation is a secondary issue. The primary issue has got to be able to control the emissions. The big thing about cities, especially cities that are emerging and how they're built, is fundamentally the sheer layout of the city. Because once you've laid out the city with the road network, with all the utilities, it becomes next to impossible to change. When the original city of Barcelona, which is medieval, became overcrowded and they wanted to expand outwards, they created this area called the Example, which is effectively a suburb. And they laid out the suburb according to quite strict rules. So it's grid formation, a bit like North American cities, but the grid is oriented slightly differently. The buildings are relatively tall. They clipped out the corners of the building to allow access to sunshine. They have a series of streets and then a series of avenues. And I think it was just happenstance that they chose the right plan at the right time. Remember, this was effectively put into operation before the car was ubiquitous, but they effectively created a grid pattern that seems to function. We have no coherent map of cities around the world. We don't know about urban landscapes around the world. So what this work was an attempt to do is harvest all the scientific evidence that's been collated over 50 years and packed it in a coherent framework, not just simply to describe the effects of the city on the climate, but to go back and study the causative processes that link the decisions we make on the urban landscape to the climate that we get.